Building institutional trust is critically important in today's fake-infested information world. But the journey towards building that trust is very challenging. Mahatma Gandhi is quoted to have said, "First, they will ignore you. Then they will laugh at you. Then they will fight you. Then you will win." The Mahatma may or may not have said that. There could be others who said it before him. Regardless of the origins of that quote, there is no doubt that there is an element of truth in it. There is a lesson in that for all those who would like to slog it out for the long run and build a winning story based on building trust. So it is building that institutional trust that is critically important in today's world. Now, this trust is not exactly clear in some cases. It's kind of elusive in some ways. So consider this. Sometimes, the implicit trust which is embedded in our actions are actually a reflection of our compulsions. So what does that mean? Consider government data. We are all slightly or considerably concerned over the reliability of government data. Say, GDP growth rate, unemployment rate, inflation rate. We kind of snigger sometimes that this data is not exactly reliable. And nevertheless, we use it when we have to use it. We will always say India is growing at this GDP. We don't say it because we don't believe in it. So there is an implicit trust in our actions because of compulsions. There are no choices. Now, suppose a private sector organization were to tell us that it could produce such data. So what will be our immediate response to that? It could range, it depends upon where you stand. It could range from incredulity, from saying that I'm deeply skeptical of the private sector doing anything of this kind, or being benign, tolerant, even encouraging. You can be anything along this entire spectrum, but it's unlikely that you will give it automatic trust. That trust is necessarily going to come out of an arduous journey of establishing the trust in the alternate narrative. Now, that is what is important, that journey of establishing trust. Now, the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy Private Limited, the company that I lead, has been in the business of building databases for the last 40 years and simultaneously trying to build trust in these databases. And as we were doing this, it is very clear that the government is losing credibility. So as we were building credibility, the government was losing credibility. We have no intention of actually going and replacing the government. It just so happens that we are into measurements. We do measurement of the economy, and the government does the same, and there is some time of face-off between the two of us. But measurement is what our passion is. That's my passion. I am focused on measurement. If we don't measure, we don't even begin to understand. If we do measure, if we can measure, we can begin to understand. If we mismeasure, we will misunderstand. So measurement is critically important in this entire story. And when it comes to numbers like GDP, unemployment, inflation, etc., these are oftentimes controversial, and I have waded into many of these controversies. So, what has been my story? I'll tell you one story, which is the most recent one, of my efforts at trying to measure employment and unemployment in this country. Early in 2016, we issued the first set of monthly estimates of the unemployment rate in India. And what did we find? That the unemployment rate in India is of the order of 10%, or even above 10%. Now, mind you, the narrative till then was that the unemployment rate in India is of the order of 2 to 3%. Now, you see why you don't believe those numbers? But if you believe those numbers, we were talking of 10%. Now, the government does not produce an unemployment rate for 5 years at a stretch. We were producing these numbers on a monthly frequency. So monthly frequency, an estimate which is 5 times the official estimate. We thought this was shock and awe. What was the response? We were ignored. As Mahatma Gandhi said, first you will be ignored. We thought we had done something great. We had a sample size which is a panel of 175,000 households. We were 50% more than the government sample. We were producing this data 60 times faster than what the government was doing. We were releasing this information in near real time, which was far away from what the government was doing. So this is obviously awesome. But what did we receive in return was that eerie silence. Government officials and agencies that produce data gave us a curious look and looked away. Those commentators or those academics who were using this government data also gave us a similar look and looked away. So we were being ignored fairly effectively. And that eerie silence was very audible to us, and the message of that eerie silence was not lost on the public at large as well. And mind you, the public at large are consumers of our data. Then came an event, a natural event in our journey of calculating the unemployment rate. There was this demonetization. The government demonetized currency notes. And it was natural that we would look at the impact of this demonetization, because we were estimating unemployment before demonetization and after demonetization. And what did we find? That the immediate impact was a loss of 12 million jobs. Some of it recovered. And the sustainable loss of that was 3 million jobs. But then soon after that, in mid-2017, we had GST, the introduction of the goods and services tax. And the combined effect of these two was a sustainable loss of 11 million jobs. That's what we found out, that the effect was quite severe. Now, we seem to have crossed some red line. And we were actively shunned, not ignored anymore. So, government officials or people thereabouts would start speaking. And what did they say? There is no credible data on unemployment in the country. 1 year after we had produced the data, they were telling us that you either don't exist or you're not credible. Make your choice. And then comes laughing at you, exactly like the Mahatma said. So what do they say? They ridicule us, saying that how can 175,000 households tell us a story about 300 million households in this country? How is it possible that you can find out what the status of an Ola driver, Uber driver is? These are gig workers. How do you know what their status is? How is it possible that the female labor participation rate in India is lower than some select Islamic countries? This was the loaded one, but nevertheless, we tried hard to explain to all these criticisms, but we were talking to a wall which was constructed on the basis of systematic, deliberate, statistical illiteracy. So it was a very deliberate, you know, you can be illiterate, but can you be deliberately, statistically illiterate? But that's what I was facing. Then came the attack. So the government actively suppressed its NSSO data. We found out after it was released eventually that the NSSO survey was saying the same thing that we were saying. They had a reason to suppress it. They released the EPFO data, which was about formalization of jobs and not about creation of jobs, but enough to spin the debate, look, there is job creation over here. Then there were more things. There were political insinuations which are running thick and fast against us. Trolls were let loose, funding was cut. So we faced it all. And by the time we reached here, we were reasonably sure, and our well-wishers and researchers and professional statisticians were saying that you're okay. We knew that we are on a winning path. We didn't have to really worry as much, but we had to continue on the path of being as transparent as possible and resilient to the onslaught. Today, we're happy to report that The Reserve Bank of India uses this data. Harvard uses this data. Most of the IIMs use this data. IMF researchers have published a paper based on it. There are lots of people who are using the data. There is one little absence over here. Delhi Research Circle does not use the data as yet. But we are on a winning path. Now, it was an interesting journey to slowly get ourselves established in this entire business of creating data. We were innovative. We found that the government was following the, of course, the ILO norms, which was that you consider a person to be employed if the person had worked at least half a day in a 7-day period. Mind you, if you're working for half a day in a 7-day period, you're employed. I thought this is ridiculously relaxed. In the remaining 6.5 days, you could be looking for a job. So we said, let's cut the reference period to just 1 day, and then there will be no confusion. On a given day, it's unlikely that you're employed and unemployed. So that made it easier. Our estimates, therefore, are a lot more reliable. And this was, in a sense, innovative. Our innovations are in such definitions. Our innovations are in the survey execution machinery, which has been appreciated by the Ministry of Statistics today. Our Ministry of Statistics appreciates it, consults us on execution. It has been appreciated by the University of Michigan, which gave us a chance to collaborate with them on exercises. So I think if you persevere, if you continue on the path of trying to, you know, get yourself right, it is possible that you will eventually get it right. You will eventually build trust in an institution that provides an alternate. We were not saying that the government was wrong. We were not saying that at all. We were just giving you an alternate, a choice to say, you can look at that data which says 2 to 3%. You can look at our data which says 10%. You can see the methodologies and take a choice. Or you can have a multidimensional view on what the employment and unemployment status in the country is. Now, we have been through this before. We have seen these challenges in our journey earlier as well. We're a 40-year-old company, so we're not new to the game, but what did we do earlier? We came up with an estimate which is an alternate to what the UN system is on the measurement of investments. So investments, you know, if you go through economic theory, is about the goods and services produced during a year are either consumed or they are invested for the future. So what you don't consume, you most likely leave it for investments. So the official systems of calculating investments is to say how much of the iron we produce or cement we produce or machinery all goes into investments. These are investments. These are inputs into investments. Iron, steel, cement, so on and so forth. We said, this is not enough, or we can have an alternate way of looking at this. Let's look at the outcomes, not just the inputs, but the outputs. How many factories did we make? How many bridges did we make? How many buildings? How many roads? Those are the outcomes. You put in as much as steel and cement you want. If you don't get a road, there's no point. So we said, let's measure the outcomes. And that's what created an entirely new set of data series called the CapEx database. We had our stress points in the past on this data, but today that information on investments is used fairly actively as a lead indicator of investments and also of business cycles. What does this tell us? The story of investments, the story of employment and unemployment is that you take enough efforts to build a good system, you be innovative, and you be persuasive. It is not enough to be innovative and produce something very nice today. It is also very important that you persuade people to use it effectively. That's what we have done. We have persuaded people to accept the data by building trust. Building institutional trust was critically important to the story. We think there is still a long way to go. There are many more things that can be done. We have traversed some path. There will be new data sets that can get created. But in this fake news infested information world, it's very important to build a critically important portion of that is to build institutional trust. That's what is very important, and that's the point that I'm trying to make. We have not tried to say the government is wrong. As I was saying earlier, our attempt is to give an alternate, to give a choice to people, to bring in multidimensionality in the estimation of various economic indicators. This will continue, and let's see how we progress in the future. Thank you very much.